And praise the Lord, brothers and sisters. We're back with the YouTube teachings. We're back in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, and we left off at verse 28. But if there be no interpreter, let him keep silent in the church, and let him speak to himself and to God. We were ready then to carry on forth into verse 29. Let the prophet speak two or three, and let the other judge. If there be anything revealed to another that sitteth by, let the first hold his peace. For ye may all prophesy one by one, that all may learn, and all may be comforted. And the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets. For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. We'll finish there now. From verse 34, you take up, let your women keep silent in the churches, and we will deal with that in another teaching and session. Now, we want to cover these several verses from 29 to 33. Let the prophets speak two or three, and let the other judge. In our previous lessons, we've been talking about the gift of prophecy. That is one of the three speaking gifts to be: prophecy, divers tongues, interpretation. Tongues with interpretation equivalent and equal to prophecy. Then he says, let the prophets speak two or three. It's a great thing to be gifted from God when he moves on you to prophesy. It's wonderful. It's great in the speaking gifts if God allows you to speak in tongue and someone come behind you with the interpretation. And it is great if God brings you on up to where you interpret first person English and you're in the gift then of prophecy. So there'd be three gifts there, three speaking gifts. One, you speak in another tongue. Two, a person would interpret that tongue. You're instructed to pray that that person would also be you. And then that there would be the gift of prophecy. So, tongues, interpretation, and prophecy. Those three make up the speaking gifts in that section of three. There are three sets of three making nine. Just to sharpen our mind and attention up again. Now here within the speaking gifts, verse 29, let the prophet speak. This will be a different speaking than the gift of prophecy being spoke. This will be them speaking. The other will be a gift working. That gift that's working will come and go in a moment. Maybe 1 minute it's gone. Maybe two or three. But it comes and goes. This, let this prophet speak. This here, you would have to be a prophet to be qualified in this. The prophet then would be one of the fivefold offices. The gift of prophecy is not in the fivefold offices. So you've got nine gifts, nine fruits, five offices, elders, deacons, and so forth, all making up the body of Christ. Now, let the prophets be in then different from let George or Mary, who work occasionally in the gift of prophecy, entirely different. Now look, 29. Let the prophet speak two or three, and let the other judge. If anything be revealed to another that sitteth by, let the first hold his peace. For ye may all prophesy one by one, that is, those that would work that way, that all may learn and all may be comforted. And the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets. For God is not the author of confusion, but the author of peace, as in all churches of the saints. God intended the giftings and the offices to be the same in every single church he planted or had anything to do with. Hence, 1 Corinthians 1:10, that you all come together, you all speak the same thing, have the same mind and the same judgment. The same thinking, the mind of Christ. The same judgment, judging righteous judgment. Speak the same thing that is written in the Word. Speak the Word, and only the Word. Speaking the Word. So then we are safe. We are on the solid rock, Christ Jesus, the Word of God. So, let the prophet speak. Now here, the word employed is prophets. Now, Philip had four daughters that were prophetesses. And stay in 1 Corinthians, but if we could look at Acts 21. Acts chapter 21. Praise the Lord. Still keep your finger there. We'll be going right back to 1 Corinthians 14. Acts chapter 21. Concerning Philip. Verse 8, Philip the evangelist. Verse 8, which was one of the seven and abode with him. Now, this is Paul's company departed and came unto Caesarea and were entered into the house of Philip the evangelist, which was one of the seven and abode with him. And the same man had four daughters, virgins, which did prophesy. 4:3-9:5, which did prophesy. And as we tarried there were days, there came down from Judea a certain prophet named Agabus. And that will lead us into an entirely other story. Now, we're interested here in this word prophecy. The four virgin daughters prophesied. They have prophecy, 4:3-9:5. And it simply means that they would alternate between foretelling, which is prophecy, and preaching. So it was an interchangeable word to foretell events. An inspired speaker, a foreteller, one that goes out in front of, is the Greek, in front of, 4:3-9:6. Both words connected, coming from the same root. In front of, an inspired speaker to foretell. Now, these four sisters, the daughters, were able to prophesy and preach. They had this dual ministry. They foretold events. Now, I want us to realize here at this juncture that foretelling events as a prophetess or prophet is different than prophesying. Prophecy, one of the three speaking gifts, prophesying, speaking for God under the unction of the gift, it comes and goes. This is an office, a gifting from God that goes back and forward from preaching and prophesying, or more to the point that singularizes it out to foretell. Now, we realize that prophecy in the church, the gift of prophecy, one of the three speaking gifts, is for edification, exhortation, and comfort. That would not be there used to be foretelling death, doom, and destruction. Like God pronouncing sentence or judgment on something and it falling down or some calamity. So there's prophecy on to exhortation, edification, and comfort. That is not what these four daughters moved in. Though they could have had that too, if God moved with that, they were certainly well qualified. Now, when I say qualified, it's not that you study and get past an exam. It's that God would be able to use you in that. Your faith through love had come up to a certain place. You knew the Word of God. You studied the Word. You could speak the Word. You were comfortable speaking for God. So in a prophecy in the sanctuary, one of the three gifts, which is of the set of speaking gifts of the nine, that gift would be edification, exhortation, and comfort. A lot different than foretelling in front of, to be above, a foreteller, an inspired speaker. A lot different. Now, the prophet or prophetess here in Acts 21, Philip's daughters, they would have to have on board to fulfill this, which is an office, not a speaking gift. Though to do both the office and the speaking gift, one needs to speak. Let that settle. The gift or the office is fulfilled by the tongue, through the vocal organs. But the prophecy in the church house when the gifts are moving is entirely different from when the prophet is moving. The prophet is called to be. The Apostle Paul said, Paul called to be. Paul called to be a prophet. Philip the evangelist. So, the church has not got this right either. For many times in the sanctuary, God is bringing that to edify the church, which has been hurt, discomforted, waylaid, deceived. He's bringing that in to edify, correct. Yes, there can be a correction in it, a general correction, like you're going the wrong way or you've missed me. So edification, exhortation, and comfort. I know at the end of the day, the correction you got is comforting to know that God has not let you go on, not forgot you. So, today there is so many prophecies that are not God. Some went and were never sent. They just prophesy. They don't think of the consequences. They just prophesy. It brings a certain notoriety if you're built that way on the flesh. And people pat the back. I've heard it. I've traveled so much. Great prophecy, brother. Well done, brother. Took a lot of courage to do that. Oh, your faith was up. Well done. You know, the whole kit and caboodle come from heaven. Well done, nothing. You know, God spoke through a donkey on the mountain pass, a little old she-jenny. God spoke. Humankind was so dumb, they thought that the donkey spoke. Begin to beat the donkey with a stick. That was no donkey speak, though God used his vocal cords to that sense. God used his mouth for it to come out of. But a she-jinny can't talk. But God talked through the she-jinny. I'm not calling you or me donkeys or anything. But God talks through us in the sanctuary through the gift of prophecy. But when God comes down with the judgment, when God pronounces something, When God foretells in advance what's going to happen, he does not use the gift of prophecy, though the gift will be containing and riding in on a voice, the tongue. What does he use? A prophet. One of the five offices. Now the danger is this. Those that prophesy, because they employ their tongue, their voice is heard by the hearing. They get puffed up, or others, not knowing these scriptures we're teaching, they call them a prophet. They look on it as the office of a prophet. It's not, and I'm not belittling it to say, it's just one of the three gifts of the speaking and one of the nine gifts of the Holy Ghost giftings. No, that's not the intent. But it is a prophecy. It is not a prophet. It's safe prophesying in the gift in the church house. Try foretelling and speaking death, doom, and destruction on the street, judging of hellfire and brimstone on the street. You better be a prophet then, because God will have endowed you and gifted you with what is needed to stand. No, I don't think we'll run. We're not needing runners' giftings to get away. We stand and they will stone or beat you up or in some way get you stopped. They hate the voice that's speaking. So let this prophet speak two or three and let the other judge. They are in safe company now as opposed to the street. Now why is that? Well, they're amongst the brethren in the church house, in the church service. So let them speak. If one has something, let the first hold his peace, and let the other speak that all may be comforted, meaning encouraged. So the prophet doesn't just speak hard things and hellfire and brimstone. He can speak both, that is. He can speak, as this translation is, he can speak comfort, exhortation, and edification. But far and over above that, he can foretell or will when God moves. So God uses him in this extension over and above the tongue being used to prophesy. One of the three speaking gifts, one of the nine overall gifts. Therefore, the prophet is different. It's an office. Whereas in the sanctuary, when some is moved on by the gift of prophecy, it is a gift. Now, the Bible will say that the five offices are a gift to the church. But the church does not go around prophesying, but it does go around representing the prophet. That is separated. That is coming out of the world, that is pointing the way to Christ, which is repentance. So the prophet has all to do with preaching against sin, of uncovering sin where others least expect it, because the prophet is gifted with several of these gifts of the nine, or he's not a prophet. Whereas you may be gifted, as God said, several to each as he will, of the gifts of the Holy Spirit in the sanctuary, and not a gift being exercised that is a gift to the church in the five offices. So we need to separate that. The prophet may prophesy, but he's a prophet that will foretell. The gift of prophecy on whosoever in the sanctuary, he only prophesies unto edification, exhortation, and comfort. He is not a preaching man or a man sent. It's the Holy Spirit sent into the man there. The prophet is lifted up out of there and taken there, moved over yonder. He comes and says, thus saith the Lord. So here is another thing that the devil has to wind up on the people. He monkeys with the situation between prophesying and the prophet. And again, not enough knowledge, wisdom, and study on this to break it open to help the church. Some folks do have it. Some churches do. There are some fine pastors that have held on to this, that have come out of the Assemblies of God and the Church of God. Yes, indeed, God will not be without a complete witness. But today, it's fading away. Each generation of 10 years added on, 10s, 20s, 30s, 40s, I'm into my fifth 10s, heading towards 50 years, probably around 45. So I've seen each 10 of change and each 10 of deception, each 10 of default, each 10 of going mad. So God wants us to speak out, to travel and speak out publicly and on YouTube and in houses, house meetings, web pages, however we can, not just warning about the Pope, the end times, not just warning about the end of the world and living holy, but warning about monkeying with God's church. Warning the people that's in under this stuff to get out. They're playing God. And God is not pleased. So we'll go to 39. We're leaving out from 34. Down to 39, because that includes let your women keep silent. And rather than just put a few passages on that and skip over that, we will do a teaching on that. We're not trying to escape from it. We're wanting to penetrate into it. So we will deal with that as the days unfold and God allows. But we're going to deal with it. It is very necessary that women have their rightful place to speaking. Don't see it anywhere as pastoral work, but definitely speak in missionary, evangelism, and so forth. Now, verse 39, wherefore, brethren, covet to prophesy. There it is. Covet to prophesy, and forbid not to speak with tongues. Let all things be done decently and in order. God wants his house filled with the gifts. That is separate from the exercising of the prophetic office, one that foretells events. Amen. So let us just bow our heads for a moment, and we'll be back with more on the nine gifts of the Holy Ghost. Father, we thank you for enabling us to get through this incredible teaching today, that we need to have you with us and aboard all the time, Lord. It is quite an endeavor to do this, that we may all be blessed and understand the workings of the Holy Ghost in the church. We're thanking you today for our salvation. We're thanking you today, Lord, the numbers are growing that's watching the YouTube messages. We thank you, Lord, that you can inspire them to tell others about it. They have their numbers, their phone numbers, their addresses. Lord, I pray that you would use the viewers and listeners to do just that and to spread the word. In Jesus' name, amen.